everyone. This is Louis Kavouras, and I want to welcome you to UNLV Arts Worldwide. And we're here with the Dean of the College of Fine Arts, our Dean, Dean Nancy Uscher.
Louis, it's such a pleasure to be with you today, and I want to welcome our audience wherever you are in the world, whether it's afternoon, morning, night, evening. Welcome.
Nancy, this is the innovation and creativity episode. So tell me, how is innovation and creativity vital in the College of Fine Arts?
Louis, I love that question. You know, I reflect back on our work together a couple of years ago when we were together as a college team creating our strategic plan, which is our blueprint for the future. And we came up with a mission about boldly launching visionaries, our students, who transform the global community through collaboration, scholarship, and innovation. So right there, you see that the idea of creativity and innovation is absolutely embedded in everything we do as a college. It's embedded in the teaching, it's embedded in what our faculty produce and create, it's embedded in the way students look upon their lives, and it's embedded in the way they make work.
I love that whole process when, you know, getting all of our units together and just exploring the fundamental building blocks of all of our arts disciplines. So, Nancy, every time I hear that mission statement, it just gives me chills. It just makes me happy.
You know, it's a wonderful growth opportunity for all of us, I think, and especially during this time of the pandemic. Of course, we feel for the people who are having a hard time. We mourn for the people who we've lost.
Too many.
But the counterpoint to that is that we are, you say in your message, we are still dancing, which really moves me. But, and we are still making art as well, together. We're working together on this project, UNLV Arts Worldwide. Our students have a lot of agency to go out and change the world. I think that one of the things that's happening during this time is that we're giving ourselves permission to experiment, to take risks, to learn what it's like to work in isolation, and to have some freedom to express ourselves and figure out the authenticity with which we proceed. You know, I think it's one of the great responsibilities and opportunities for artists in the world to create original work. And if you wouldn't mind, I'm going to tell a little piece of a story that I told in my last message on Monday to the college. Is that okay?
Yes, I'd love that.
So many years ago, it was actually 1989, I was in residence at the University of the South Pacific in Fiji. And a wonderful man named Oweta Salamona picked me up in his Jeep at the airport. He knew who I was because I was the only person who descended the stairs carrying a viola. And he immediately came to me and I said to him, Mr. Salamona, you know about me because you invited me. I'd sent materials, but I don't know about you and I'm really interested in your background. And Mr. Salamona proceeded to tell me that he had been blessed to have a Fulbright scholarship to attend college for 4 years in the United States, and then went back to his native Western Samoa and to Fiji, and he just pledged to himself that he would create things that were not there before. And so he created a Western orchestra, he created a Samoan indigenous music program, he did correspondence courses with the Solomon Islands and Tonga and other places that didn't have arts education. He created a police band on Fiji and so forth. And we were going to play a recital. I was asked to play a recital. I said, Mrs. Salamona, who is the pianist who will be playing on the recital? Well, actually, I am. Mrs. Salamona, you said I was going to be playing an original viola piece. Who is the composer? Well, actually, I am. And Louis, at the time I was writing a book called Your Own Way in Music, A Career and Resource Guide. And I didn't know the focus yet of the book. I had a contract, but I wasn't quite there yet. And when I heard Mr. Salamona's story, I thought to myself, now I know what the book will be about. Now I know why it's important that I write this book. And the message was that each one of us has the opportunity, the agency, the creativity, the originality to to produce something that wasn't there before and to really change the lives of so many other people. And just as they're trying right now in the pandemic, and we're all rooting for the scientists to create a vaccine, to create a way that we can come out of isolation at the right time, in a very like manner, artists heal society. We've talked about that last episode. We bring well-being, and artists too need to create new knowledge, and we do. And so I want to say that that Fiji experience helped solidify in me something I've carried with me ever since, which is that our faculty and our students, all of them exceptional, will go out into this world, and many already have, and create wonderful work that will change the world, will transform the way people think. I believe that truly.
I adore that, Nancy. And I love that idea that we empower ourselves to just boldly launch ourselves into the future and make amazing work. Well, this is UNLV Arts Worldwide, and this is our innovation and creativity episode. Let's get inventive.
This all started as a way for my students to see each other every day. I just had a meeting with my studio and said, hey, if you all are interested, not required, you can drop into the meeting room and I'm going to be doing a warm up there and you can play along with me or you can just have the sound going. But, you know, some people will be there. So it'll be a way for us all to kind of be together without getting to see each other. And then I thought, well, I have some private students too, so why don't I invite them to join in? So I did. And then I thought, well, I know that there's a lot of young saxophone students out in Las Vegas area who can't reach their teachers right now for lessons or for guidance or can't afford lessons right now. So I thought, okay, I'm just going to open this up to some high schools that I have good connections with. So I emailed some band directors and said, send these along to your students. They just have to click this link and I will be there in the morning at 9 a.m. doing a warm up and they can join in. And so I got some interest and people started showing up. And then I thought, more people need this. So I put it on Facebook and said, hey, Nevada saxophonists. Actually, I think it said Nevada High School saxophonist, come join me for a warm-up. And I got so many responses that were not from Nevada High School students. They were from people who I had gone to school with that just wanted to drop in, have a little motivation to practice early in the morning or at noon, considering where you are. East Coast, it'd be noon. Central Time, it'd be 11. Mountain Time, 10. Because we're doing it at 9 a.m. here. And then I got people sending links to their students, which was great. And I said, of course, let your students come in. And then I got messages from people in Ecuador and from the Philippines and from Hong Kong and from Singapore. And people just wanted to know if they could join it too and join the warm-up. And I said, well, I don't see why not. So yeah, go ahead and join. So we've had people from all over the world coming and just watching me warm up in my makeshift office, and it's great.
Okay, so we're gonna do this and we're gonna push the tempo a bit. So remember, G, B, D, G, down the whole scale. One, two, ready?
I think people who are showing up are coming for the warm up, of course, but I think they're leaving with that same feeling after you leave a group of friends or you've just left a party or something, you know, like you've gotten your social interaction for the day or for the morning. And I think that sets up a lot of people to be in a better position mentally to be able to focus on their academic pursuits or their artistic goals or countless other things. Because the important thing right now is finding stability and what that means, finding people that you can reach out to, finding sources of food, finding safety, shelter, all that stuff. And I think this serves as being that social network, people you can reach out to. And if people stay on after the warm-up, they will ask me questions and I talk a little bit with them. And I think it's doing more than just helping with saxophone. I think it's helping people connect when it's become very difficult to do so. Lots of things to add on to this, but for what it is right now, for what it started out being, I feel like it's just grown into something more beautiful than I could have imagined.
Full range. Good. We're gonna keep it moving.
So the way it works is people sign into the Zoom meeting and I'm not hearing them. They have their mics on mute, but my sound is being pumped out into their speakers. So I am acting like a drone so they can play along with me, or I am their metronome so they have to keep time during those portions of the warm-up. And it's kind of nice because some of the skills that we are working on in the warm-up are things that some students may be scared to do in front of others. So this is no risk, no one's going to hear them. It kind of allows them to tackle new skills that they would be scared to do in front of others. They're in the privacy of their own room. They're hearing me do it and they can try their best to make it happen. So if you're lacking motivation to get your horn out and play, or you just want to see some friendly faces, feel free to join the live warm-up. We'll be here Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, 9 a.m. Pacific time. Hope to see you there.
Hi, everyone. I'm Phil Hubbard from the Department of Theater. I'm here with my colleague, Michael Lugering. We're here to talk about his work in the expressive actor, integrated voice movement and acting technique. Michael and I have worked together for 20 years here at the university, and this work has been the foundation for the voice and movement studies that we do, and the acting studies, quite frankly. I use it in my classes. I use it in my work as an actor. It is innovative and has been innovating for, you know, almost over 20 years now as he's worked and developed the work. We'd like to talk about how it came about, what it is, some of the influences on it, that sort of
thing. I just sense intrinsically that there was a disconnect between what was going on in the acting class and the voice class and the movement class. That was not a stroke of brilliance. Everyone seemed to think that that was true. And in many ways, the movement class was maybe perhaps trying to bring someone to neutral, you know, so sort of a very balanced, very even, very measured place without idiosyncrasies. And perhaps in the voice class, they might be trying to restore, you know, get rid of past tensions and free the actor up. And the acting class was often acting them to identify with their fundamental, you know, memories perhaps, or, you know, working in a very, very different way. So it seemed to me that there's always an essential question. I think every one of those things is valid, and they're all trying to put an actor into a place where they can respond spontaneously and naturally and authentically in imaginary circumstances. So what I tried to do with my work over time, I think, was say, what are the physical components of truth, of authenticity? That I was interested that Susan Langer said the body has a natural form. There's a living form that is rooted in action, that allows us to recognize, to distinguish, if you will, my alive dog from my vacuum cleaner. And what that says is that there are actually physical properties of the sense of being alive. And what that means is that physical truth can be taught physically by describing the manner with which a character shifts their weight. And I think it begins for me with a shift of weight,
right,
rather than an imagination, a memory, you know, a given circumstances. I think all of those things are embedded in a shift of weight. I do think we can look to neuroscience to challenge us to think about the acting process differently. And I think it's not that the other things, that our past goes away. I mean, I think that would be wrong to forget whose shoulders that we stand on. But I also think we have to reach and climb up on the next generation and the next generation. And I think the body will play a very important role in the thinking and feeling process, not just training it to stand up straight and breathe well.
Well, it's great to talk about the work, and it's great to have, we have had an artistic partnership in this training program for many, many years. And I appreciate always these conversations about the work, where it fits in, how we move forward, and how it gives us something to do and something to work on in a practical way. So great chatting with you about this.
Thanks. So, it's always fun to chat with you about this.
I was finally convinced at UNLV, but I was bitten by the bug before, because when I was working at a production company here in El Salvador, I got a chance to work with really good cinematographers, and I figured out early on that they were having all the fun, or at least in my eyes, they were having all the fun.
So welcome, Mr. Eduardo Mayen.
Thank you.
You're quarantined where right now?
I'm quarantined in El Salvador, Central America, my home country and your home country.
Yes, that's correct. Our guest today is Eduardo Mayen, who is a working union cinematographer. He's done features, he's done television, and documentaries, features, and award-winning shorts. Long time ago, I met this young man in my home country of El Salvador, and I did what I do to every person who's interested in film that I meet. I hand them my card and said, if you're interested in studying film, come and do this. And it was great. You know, I was very happy to actually see you progress and move forward very quickly in that direction. You did come and you know, most of the people I give a card to, I get a call. With you, I got a call and a visit, and you wanted to kind of see what UNLV was like. I invited you to participate in our first big, we've been doing the co-curricular project in different ways, but our first major one had a $30,000 budget, and that's Medio Tiempo right behind me. Do you remember the first thing I said when you got off a plane?
We're going to put you in the movie because I had a shaved head.
We trained over 50 students in different positions, some rotating and some not, and finished a film which went on to the Showtime Latino Filmmakers Showcase. And you were sort of at the center of the film as shadowing me and also being in it. And the irony was not lost on me when I got to shadow you on the Amazon show that you were directing for Gordon McGibbon's Life on Normal Street. Just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. And then it goes back, and then it goes back, and then it goes back. You had a motivation not only to become a cinematographer, but you were constantly ingesting information all the time. But I mean, you were very inspired by Robert Rodriguez. And I mean, that was like a big deal. And when we went to Sundance, you actually got to meet him and shake his hand. I was able to say, oh, he was one of my students and this and that. And it was a big deal. And you end up working with him on a Quentin Tarantino based screenplay for a TV series called Dusk Till Dawn. I mean, you're the DP of the pilot and the alternating DP, and you end up doing most of the episodes the first season, right?
Yes, that was surreal.
Very clear that what you were going to do was going to become an American Film Institute alum as a fellow in cinematography. And it happened in the sense that you got accepted, right, to the AFI.
I did. I mean, that's what I wanted. That was my dream.
And you didn't have the money. You had a interesting mentor at UNLV by the name of Michelle Hugo. Do you want to tell me a little bit about your relationship with Michelle and what that was like?
We had American Society of Cinematographer member come to be our cinematography professor. Kind of showed me how a professional cinematographer behaved on set, and the charm and the way to communicate with the crew, how to motivate the crew. It gave me the first glimpse of a professional persona on set, which became a role model.
Do you remember any of the classes you took at UNLV? And if so, what was the value you got out of them?
I remember a lot of them. I remember directing actors. Was it directing actors? Advanced directing, which was brutal. But I feel like it helped us grow a lot and understand acting, seeing acting from a different way. That was a good class. That was a memorable class. Kurosawa class with Wegner, that was a real, I mean, learning the language of cinema from Akira Kurosawa was an incredible filmmaking lesson.
I'm teaching that online next summer.
It's fantastic. I love that class. Storytelling, story development, when we used to tell stories. Listen, that's the basis of it. Right, that was the scaffolding to the building. You know, if you don't know how to tell a story or like create a narrative, right, how can you be a filmmaker? That is like I think every filmmaker should take that class, because you understand plot and you understand how things develop, and you're seeing your audience first up react to what you're telling them. So that was like the first instance of me getting an audience reaction to my work, if it was just me telling stories. But that's the primal basis of it all.
Our first time, and we were second in the world and first in the nation, that's a tremendous accomplishment. And that wasn't just me saying it, that was other kind of national officials saying that too. So that really means a lot.
Their secret to success should be no surprise, coming from a school with UNLV's growing solar energy reputation.
Solar decathlon is something that we found out about, one, just from our congressional delegation. They brought it to us and they said, this is something you guys should be going for. We also just knew about it because this is something we're doing a lot in solar energy and renewable energy.
While encouraging the collaborative and real-world experiences that lend so much relevance to a university education.
I guess for the people who say that it's impossible or they're not ready for their change, is that, you know, I think the change has to happen. It has to happen now. It's not whether we can postpone it for 30 years, 50 years. It's an issue that's affecting every single person on this planet. It's a change that needs to happen.
The Solar Decathlon is an international collegiate competition to build and design an energy efficient home.
Each team is building a house that saves energy, saves water, uses solar energy, and just makes it the most sustainable house as possible.
So we're designing and innovating and bringing in technology to build homes that are able to function on either off-grid or heavily reliant on renewable solar energy.
Desert Bloom is an energy-neutral or autonomous home that will thrive in the harsh Mojave Desert climate and operate independent of all public utility services. It combines new and emerging off-shelf renewable energy systems, technologies, products, and appliances that promote sustainability.
In my School of Architecture, we are very proud to run the design and build lab. which allows students to build something before they graduate hands-on and to be involved in real projects. And that makes all a lot of difference.
With us being in our own department, we're kind of in a little bubble where we're around like-minded individuals, and we all have individual ideas, but we all kind of have like the same stance on things. Whereas with architecture, we're looking at the aesthetics, we're looking at how does it make people feel. Whereas engineering, they're focusing on making things work, like how do we get to point A to point B. And these are things that we're going to have to deal with in the real world once we get in the job force, because engineers, civil engineers, architects, we're all going to be working together. So I feel like this is a good transition to the professional realm.
Something that's going to reflect on the real world is the butting heads between, not just between groups, because things have to fit a certain way or different systems have different requirements just within engineering, but also kind of get coordinating with architecture and the civil engineers and how certain things have to be laid out for them to make sense, you know, from an engineer's perspective and from an architect's perspective.
So who is Desert Bloom for? A scientist? Musician? Student? Filmmaker? Artist? Athlete? The next generation?
Our inspiration was our target market, actually, which in this case is returning veterans. There are many veterans in our community, particularly from the Afghanistan and Iraq conflicts, and there are a whole host of challenges that this community is dealing with. Everything from PTSD to higher incidence of suicide, many other social challenges. We realized that there are opportunities for us to positively impact this community, and that's exactly where our focus has been, and that's what inspired the competition for us.
It's important that as a society we focus on the idea of designing for differing abilities, because we all have differing abilities. There is no true generic or true normal as far as an individual goes. And if we really are following the practice of how do we design, how do we affect our lives, then we need to start looking at how we impact how we can function. So we shouldn't have to adapt to our environments, but our environment should be able to adapt to us.
This house is designed to provide a sense of security for the veteran, while at the same time giving them the openness of a typical residence.
The landscape is very important, because that's what the inhabitant is going to see before they enter. Not only that, but it's also going to be determining their views when they're looking out through the windows, and it's also going to determine what they're looking at when they're in the courtyard. So it's the aesthetic aspect is very important.
This idea of openness, of visibility, of connecting with nature, which a lot of our plants have kind of been drawn from this idea of biophilia and that connection to nature and the way that it directly alleviates stress, it directly reduces anxiety and anger. So bringing plants into the home, we've got the living green wall in there, and then a lot of grasses and a lot of plants that'll bring movement outside of the home, all easily viewable because you've got this big glass open courtyard in the middle. And the grasses actually have it's like when they move with the wind, it's called non-rhythmic movement. And that's like kind of like when you hear like rain falling on the roof, you know, that it can actually kind of like lull you into calmness. So it kind of has the same effect. Using those ideas, these ideas of design, and then working closely with engineering, closely with landscape architecture, to really kind of flush these ideas out into a directly applicable design that caters to all of these needs while still being sustainable and still bringing the best type of environment into the home.
In terms of solar, we're using, it's a solar collector, so what that does is it captures the heat energy from the sun, and we use that to heat up water as opposed to using a gas or electric boiler.
One of the cool innovations is a solar thermal box. So basically, when you have a whole mechanical room with all the valves and gadgets spread out on like the wall with the plumbing, we're going to put all of those valves and tanks and little components into a box that's going to stick to the solar thermal tank. So that's one of the innovative features we have. And that way, this kind of box can be transportable and put into any living space that is particularly small. That way, it makes it easier for the user.
We're kind of coming at it from all these different angles of, with the sole goal of making lives better for this specific person.
Providing this type of design to veterans is extremely important.
Thank you for joining us for our innovation and creativity episode. I want to leave you with one final thought. Someone recently asked me, Lewis, what is a dance? And I thought for a moment, and I thought, well, when it all boils down, a dance is just simply a kinetic metaphor. In movement, we capture an idea. And when you study creativity, you realize that we use metaphors all the time. In normal discourse, human discourse, there are four fixed metaphors and two really flexible metaphors. The fixed ones are ones we always know. It's the flexible ones. Those are the ones we're most interested in the arts. They somehow challenge us. They challenge the way we think, and they make us look at things differently. They become strange and unusual tools. In a single metaphorical image, in the arts, we're able to capture all of human consciousness in one and distill it down into one perfect moment. And that happens in every one of our arts. Thanks for tuning in, and let's keep being inventive.